but sweet. He's so fine, he can't be beat. He's got everything that I desire. Sets the summer sun on fire. I want candy. I want candy. So this is an important maxim that we need to understand, and I would refer you to podcast 14. It augments this one quite nicely about why we're not what we eat. So the economy of our bodies is something I drew up here on the left. The body runs on quarters. That's the bottom right, ATP. So the way the quarters are made is something called the citric acid cycle or Krebs cycle. You might have remembered falling asleep on this in high school chemistry. And that runs acetyl-CoA, which is like $1 bills, all right? So bear with me. The fats and the lipids are like Krugerrands. That's where you store a lot of energy, and you can cash those into dollars. Proteins is a different kind of thing, but those can also be converted by chemical reactions into dollars. So those are like euros. Now, the main backbone of this is carbohydrates. So what circulates is glucose, galactose, fructose, sucrose. These are sugars. They're like $2 bills, and through these pathways, they get converted to pyruvic acid, acetyl-CoA, and then into quarters. For short-term storage, we store in the muscle and the liver something called glycogen, which is like a billfold of $2 bills. So that's basically what it is. So the reason the Inuit, a.k.a. Eskimo people, are shown on the right is they're just eating whales and seals. There's no veggies up there, and yet somehow they're able to synthesize everything except the vitamins, and they're able to make carbs and proteins. So a person who eats all carbs is not going to be all carbs. They're going to make proteins and fat. The person who eats all protein will make the other two. So we are not what we eat. People that eat a lot of cholesterol aren't necessarily going to have a high cholesterol. So it all comes down to economy. How many calories in, how many calories out. Now, as we get older, there are aberrations that happen, specifically non-insulin-dependent diabetes, but we'll discuss that in a bit. Okay, euglycemia means good glycemia. So the function of glucose as the $2 bill is to give energy to the cells. So how is this controlled? There's like an internal glucostat or thermostat in the body, and you have to maintain blood glucose in a very tight range. When the blood sugar goes up, say after a meal, then the insulin is released in response by the pancreas, and that drives glucose into the liver to be stored as glycogen, into fat cells to be stored as fat, and into muscle, again, as glycogen and protein. The glucagon is the opposing sister hormone, so when the blood sugar is low, the glucagon is released also by the pancreas in the alpha cells, the insulin being the beta cells, and when your blood sugar is low, the glucagon will be excreted, which will mobilize the glycogen, the fat, and everything else to put you in that nice little balance. The pancreas is a fun little organ. It's this little tongue-like protrusion wrapping around the duodenum, and it serves a couple of functions. One we talked about, which was alpha cells secrete glucagon to raise the blood sugar and create a lot of glucose in the bloodstream, and insulin allows you to store it into the cells. Now, the other tree going by here is the acini cells, and that's why they said in residency there's three rules of surgery: eat when you can, sleep when you can, and don't mess with the pancreas. Pancreas is full of all these digestive enzymes, so if you touch it, it'll start to dissolve itself and you'll be in a world of hurt. But it squirts all these nice proteases and lipases into the duodenum, and that's what helps you digest the food. Cool. So what does insulin do? Insulin moves glucose into the cells. When you have a lot of glucose, the insulin will store that for a hungry day. That is what makes us fat. And the glucose is also driven into glycogen storage, which we talked about. This is illustrated below. When there is a lot of glucose, the insulin receptor is activated and the glucose is ported in, and all these chemical reactions that we alluded to take place. The glucagon simply cashes in your savings, so when you have a low glucose, the glucagon is moved out of the liver, and you get glycogenolysis, and this is why babies can't sleep through the night, because they can't store enough glycogen, so they get hungry. Also, in the conditions of low glucose, the body will mobilize the fats. Okay, we got some probably Maasai people. They're tall, but we all evolved as hunter-gatherers. And so what is the nature of evolution, if you believe in that sort of thing? Well, there just wasn't a lot of food around. You didn't have the big gulp sodas that Giuliani wants to get rid of, and there wasn't any food. You had to catch it, kill it, grow it, pick it. So when there was food, guess what? You had to store it as fat. That was a good thing. And so this is illustrated on the left. When we see the blood glucose go up in the red, the blue insulin levels also will go up and store it for a rainy or a hungry day. This is the normal function of the body. And so you see these peaks, say, breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and that's a good thing. Dr. Atkins in the 70s came up with this theory, which is very true, that if you have a lot of carbs, then it gets stored as fat. So if you don't take carbs, then you'll be mobilizing fat. What are the symptoms of diabetes, per se? There are three. Two of them go hand in hand. They're polyuria and polydipsia. That's peeing a lot and drinking a lot. So the way this works is when there's excess glucose, it spills over into these little functional units of the kidney called the nephron. Usually the kidney is 100% able to absorb all the glucose and preserve it, which is a good thing. You don't want to be wasting your $2 bills. If there is glucose in the urine, it's indicative of an overflow. There's too much blood level, and then that creates an osmotic diuresis. So that just, if you remember from high school chemistry, when there's a lot of molecules or particles in a fluid, it'll draw fluid into it, and that's why people pee a lot, hence they drink a lot. Diabetes being from the Greek for diabelin, or to pass through, or water just passes through you. The third of the triad of symptoms is hunger, which isn't necessarily intuitive until you think about what the role of insulin is. When insulin is insufficient, there's no signal to transport the glucose into the cells. So that's like a thermostat that's frozen over. Okay, the hunger cells in the hypothalamus can't get any blood sugar inside, so they think you're starving, even though there's tons of glucose outside the cell. And that's simply why you get hungry, even though your blood glucose could be through the roof. So what is normal glucose level? This tight band is kind of the same thing as we saw a couple slides ago, peak, peak, peak. This is the way it should work, peak, peak, peak. You get breakfast, lunch, you get dinner. So there's a lag. Your blood sugar gets up, all this wonderful food surges into your system, and then the pancreas secretes from the beta cells insulin. And the upshot of that is that you maintain this tight range, basically, you know, from about 80 to about 120, for all normal people. When the insulin is insufficient for whatever reason, then you get these swings and we get diabetes. And just to tease you, there are two forms of diabetes. One is caused by a virus and one is caused by getting old. And we'll talk about that in a bit. How do you quantify someone's glycemic control over the long haul? Well, we have this wonderful test called glycosylated hemoglobin. There are different flavors of this, but suffice it to say that the most commonly used one is A1C. So when glucose is bathing the red blood cells, then the hemoglobin in these red blood cells gets glycosylated, or sugar-coated, let's say, candy-coated. And over the course of, I think it's like, you know, 10 to 14 weeks, the long-term glycemic levels are reflected pretty well by the A1C. So what does that look like? Good control for you and me, if we don't have diabetes, would be A1C less than 6%, and that's indicative of staying within those green bands below 135. As you get more out of control, the average 205, 240, we see that the A1C goes up proportionally. So what are the types of insulin? Again, we see these sine waves in the bottom left. Sugar goes up, the insulin lags, and this is the natural way of things to keep a normal blood sugar. In the hunger part of it, then the glucogen would be released and you would be mobilizing fat and glycogen to create higher blood sugar. When you have to inject artificial or bovine or porcine insulin, you have these different flavors. The first is rapid acting. But there are other forms that people commonly take, such as NPH, which is longer lasting. So if you take this, it will give you a steady basal level throughout the day. And typically, when we used to manage this in pregnant women, which is the same deal, the person would stick their finger after breakfast, lunch, dinner, at bedtime, and then you would modulate these split doses. And there's many clever ways to do this, but you're just trying to keep the blood sugar from going too high. And so people that get ill or stressed people who are exercisers, and all diabetics become experts in what foods they should and shouldn't be taking in. And unless you're a very brittle diabetic, it's something that you can learn. What's the glycemic index? So again, we go back to Atkins, who knew that highly glycemic foods were carbs, the white foods, white pasta. Milk is very glycemic, white bread. Whereas the natural grains, the more brown foods, the proteins, even the fats, look at the sugar peak on the upper left. It peaks 8 hours later. So that's not going to throw your blood glucose, which is really the currency we're talking about, up very fast. If, on the other hand, you have a glass of milk because of the lactose, or you have some pasta or rice, your carbs shoot way up, and the insulin needs to shoot way up as well. And it's a good education in nutrition for people to have insulin-dependent diabetes because they really see the differences in what you eat. So the first disease is type 1 juvenile. It used to be called juvenile or insulin-dependent diabetes. This is a totally different beast, and there's been a lot of exciting research in the last couple of years that people always suspected. When I was in med school 20 years ago, they suspected, but now they confirm that it is a virus that drives this. It's Coxsackie B, and so this appears to afflict the pancreas, or maybe it afflicts somehow generating autoantigens, but the autoantibody response is primed, and then you basically destroy your good beta cells, so you can't produce insulin. Onset is sudden, often in children, but it can be, as with one of the people that we interviewed, in adulthood. People are usually thin, and they can go into what's called ketoacidosis, which means the blood sugar levels are so high and that you're starving, and so the ketones are actually mobilized from the fat, and you get this sweet-smelling odor from your breath, and you can go into real metabolic crisis. Again, there are antibodies, and this is not that concordant. It's not that genetic. Half of identical twins will share that tendency, and it's fairly infrequent. So it's just an idiosyncratic autoimmune reaction to a Coxsackie B challenge. So type 2 diabetes is a totally different disease. This comes from being fat, and I had a variant of type 2 diabetes, and we'll discuss this a little bit. It comes on gradually. It's mostly in adults, and as you get older, your liver cells accumulate fat. They become bigger. Your omental cells, your visceral central fat, becomes plumper. Your pancreas starts to not work as well. And so this is the downward spiral that we get, and it's coupled with inflammation and depression, hypertension, low testosterone. And this is not typically an insulin failure. In fact, you can have high insulin levels. It's insulin resistance. Very concordant with twins, meaning that there's a high genetic component and very common, especially in our fat modern society. This is a fun slide that I made that was actually reiterated by the LifeLength company, and now I'm stealing what they borrowed from me. So here is the gist of what I think is going on. At the heart of all processes are shortening of the telomeres, which results in DNA damage, and that results in aging, which is dysfunction, and apoptosis, which is hopefully death and replacement by something younger. So this is the same process in all organs. When you look at the cellular level, and then extrapolate to the organ level, in the brain, that would be Alzheimer's, dementia. These are all aging diseases. In the heart, we have cardiovascular disease, hypertension, et cetera, going around until we wrap around to the beta cells. Probably it's not just the beta. It probably has something to do with the adipocytes, maybe even more so than the beta cells. But there's a dysfunction in the insulin to glucagon balance and function, and that's where we get in trouble. But aging is definitely associated with diabetes, and the reason why short telomeres are associated with all these conditions is because it is the same disease, shortening in the stem cell telomeres. Okay, evidence. Here's an interesting study published, just about less than a month ago. This published in July, EPUB, and then published this month. So this is all very cutting-edge stuff that we're sharing with you. It says that as the telomeres shorten, and as this other hormone, adiponectin, which is featured in podcast 14, which we won't talk about, gets low, this is the constellation of things with diabetes. So what they found was that bad fasting blood sugar, high hemoglobin A1C, high LDL, all these bad things that we think about, are associated with shortening telomeres, and this is part of the process of getting old, getting diabetes, getting metabolic syndrome. A study from last year, 2011, showed that these dysfunctional beta cells are alive, but they're phoning it in. They're not working very well. And they were looking for apoptosis, which if you ask the wrong question, you get the wrong answer. So they're saying, another article I could quote says there is apoptosis in diabetes with shortening telomeres. But the point is, when you get somewhat damaged cells, stem cells, then you get somewhat damaged dysfunctional beta cells. This is a process. It doesn't mean that they're going to have apoptosis because that's an end-stage process on the cellular level. So hopefully, as occurred with me, you will get apoptosis. It's actually a good thing because it means that the cells are so damaged that they're able to recognize their own damage and kill themselves, only to be replaced by, we hope, better mesenchymal stem cells and then better function. So what's the evidence that TA65, which is the nutraceutical telomerase activator that I've been taking since 07, what's the evidence that it does anything? Well, here's Maria Blasco, the leading researcher in telomere biology. She did this study on mice, and she took mice that were 2 years old and 1 year old. And I want to just show here that in the third set of three, the older ones didn't have as big a change. The p-value is 0.18, 0.9. So in between the control and the TA65 group wasn't that much difference because it's harder to fix an old animal, just like it's harder to fix an old car. So the upshot of that is you should be taking this stuff when you're 21, not when you're 81. And that was shown in the rats. Now, if we just took the one-year-old younger rats, we have a dose response and temporal relationship, which is highly suggestive of causality. So what does that fancy talk mean? When you look at the one-year guys out at 12 months, the effect had waned. So in the second row across, you get glucose tolerance, insulin levels, and these are different, but not as different as they were at 6 months out. So the more recent the treatment in the younger mouse, the better. And that's what we're hearing anecdotally from patients with regard to their glycemic control. Look here with the mice, there was only a 2 out of 1,000 chance it was random that the TA65 mice that were younger and recently treated had lower glucose tolerance purely by chance. It was statistically significant, as was the insulin levels, but almost, it was 0.08. So, but, you know, suffice to say, the reason why I did this podcast is the reason why I do every podcast is somebody called me and said, hey, my blood sugar, my A1C is amazing. My doctor can't figure out why. And then the second person says, oh, hey, by the way, my diabetes is getting better. And then once a third or fourth person says that, you know, I filed away. And so the person that got this one going was Linda Lowe, a lovely lady I met, an artist I met at the lecture I gave in Sun Valley Wellness Festival. And she has a very interesting story of how she contracted this gastrointestinal illness, which was obviously Coxsackie B, and then went a while without knowing why she was thirsty and why she had these symptoms. And by the time she rolled in and some doc ordered a glucose, it was in the 500 range. I mean, she had a hemoglobin A1C that was like, you know, upwards of 13%, I think. And so some miracle she didn't go into ketosis and die, but somehow she was managing to hang on. And she called me and said, why don't we, what's going on here? And I said, well, let's do an experiment. Why don't you try a higher dose of TA65 for a week? Try 4 instead of 1. And she's very, very diligent about watching. And she saw that there were like 10% changes in the amount of insulin required for a time, which was inducible for about 3 weeks, and then it slowly started to fade, which made me think that there is some kind of competitive advantage going on while you're taking the TA65. Indeed, Susie, whose mom is diabetic and in kidney failure, a couple of years ago she took it for Christmas, and her insulin requirements went from about 40 units to about 20 briefly while she was taking it. So there is a stimulation of the healthy beta cells. But what we really want is apoptosis. So look here at the bottom here. There's less fatty liver in the in the mice that were treated with TA65, and that, I believe, is what happened to me. TA65 increases hepatocyte or liver hepatocyte, that's liver cells, telomerase activity. So look here, there's like a 12-fold increase when you give TA65. Also in other organs, but mainly in the liver. And this is reflected in the inability of my golf partner to get drunk despite 5 shots of tequila on our member tournament. He had taken 8 capsules the night before. Also, but it was good because when he went to Ibiza, he was able to drink day and night and not get a hangover. And so that was an upside. So the liver gets very efficient at clearing alcohol. Of course, one of the other functions of the liver is to maintain glycemic balance and glycogen storage. So believe it or not, when Susie started working with me 5 years ago, I started taking the TA65. And with 3 months, I had lost 20 pounds. And all my fatty liver, my abnormal liver function, my high cholesterol, low HDL, and my belly fat all went away, and went away for good. And that the only way that could have happened, I believe, was apoptosis, or death of those bad cells, those bad stem cells. Here is proof of that. Back in 07, before TA, I had an ALT of 81, and then it corrected down to the 30 range. The cholesterol was 222. It went down, 178. Also, my testosterone, which was low, bumped up, which was great. So what I believe happened there was the bad fat cells were unstable, and they finally, as a result of probably telomere lengthening and BRCA recognition and telomere handling, they killed themselves, and they were replaced by younger versions. Hooray! So now I can eat In-N-Out and Chick-fil-A, and I will never get that fat anymore. In 10, 20 years, I might, but at this point, it's not happening. Let's listen to Bill and Ben Harris, who are featured in the podcast 21 about epigenetics and twins. The interesting thing here is they're identical, but they look totally different when they came in. They've been taking almost 2 years now, and they're looking much more identical again. But this is his comment. He sees a fancy concierge doc, and the doc is not privy to the fact that they're taking the TA65. So it's not explicitly mentioned, but hemoglobin A1C and fasting glucose were a big part of what he's referring to. But let's listen to their fun little interview I had with them early on.
What's his general assessment of you?
Well, he's a really great doctor, but he once again he looks at my labs,
mm-hmm.
looks at my labs, and then says gets into the deal that hey, you're a different person than you were here 6 months ago. What are you doing? And I said, I'm exercising,
mm-hmm.
probably eating a little better and so on, but he was astounded.
So he doesn't know anything is up.
He knows nothing.
And so he just, as a gestalt, or the numbers and the gestalt?
He says, when you came in here, well, he actually said, when you came in here, you were a piece of garbage.
You pay this guy to treat you like
yeah.
That's
good. Well, I felt pretty good when I came in. Well, everything has changed. You're better. You're totally healthy right now. You're
really?
As healthy as you can get.
Really?
And so that's anecdotal, obviously not causal, but we hear that a lot about people's A1Cs, and it's just interesting, isn't it? Any questions at all? So I hope I was able to convince you that insulin resistance is part of a syndrome, which I had, metabolic syndrome, where you're not processing the sugar right. And so this is really, I believe, and you can look at the podcast on obesity, it's only because the fat cells get damaged, the stem cells of the fat, and they get big plump and chubby fat cells and make a chubby person and diabetes, which is an effect of aging. Hard to say. I did this webinar kind of late at night. I don't know if it was intelligible or unintelligible, but hopefully you've all picked up a little bit about diabetes. And understand that we're all going to get diabetes, just like we're all going to get cancer of every organ, unless we prevent it with telomerase activity. So, you know, kids with one gene copy or one functioning copy, they die at 12 of old age. We with 2 die at 80. If we had more or more active at a younger time, potentially we could be immortal. Nobody would say that having 2 copies is a violation against nature. But they say that, you know, taking telomerase activation maybe is not a good thing. Well, I disagree. I mean, a person can service their car before it gets damaged and drive to 2.4 million miles, so much the better. So we really have to get out of this paradigm of disease that we've been handed and understand that all cells are good and they're trying to live, and when they're not good, they're trying to die. And this is the process that we are enhancing naturally and safely by taking TA65. Oh, Ray asks, what's my current age versus my physical age? Well, my current age is 45, and my physical age, telomere age, is like a 3-year-old now. It's like 9,800, and so it's all good. And it's a dynamic thing as well. So diabetes, just because you have a high blood sugar, totally different processes. One is this weird genetic autoimmune thing, and the second is coming to all of us if we don't maintain our telomeres and stay thin. There's ample literature I could have quoted, but I realized that just generates a lot of ennui, so I didn't do that. Are you still convinced that, Greg asks, oh, hey, Greg, how are you doing, sir? Are you still convinced that calories in versus calories used is a major determinant of weight? I guess what you're trying to feed me, the slow ball question, is that it's not the calories in, it's the glycemic nature of them. So, yeah, 1,000 kilocalories of sugar or bread is much more fattening than 1,000 kilocalories of fat. It's kind of like the Galileo experiment in Pisa. For Greg's question, Stan is also helping. He says, Gary Taub's book, Why We Get Fat. Yes, of course, basal metabolic rate is critical because it has to do with flow. Calories in a high insulin environment, will cause you to be fat. Calories in while you're running one of your triathlons or swim races isn't going to allow the glucose to be stored. It'll be used in action. So, yeah, there are a lot of variables going on. Hi, Ruth. How are you? Ruth was featured in the traumatic brain injury. She and Don are talking a lot more and having great conversations, and he's starting to find words again after severe damage from head trauma to his Broca's area. So very happy to hear about you. Insulin resistance. Oh, I think Ruth was one of those that said her glucose was getting better as well. Insulin resistance is a phrase that people use, perhaps a bit unfortunate. It could be just insulin dysfunction, but it's a phenomenological explanation. It says that people who are fat with these fat cells who have high blood sugars, they got a lot of insulin, so hence it must be resistant. I think it's a gross oversimplification and probably not an accurate representation. What we're really talking about is a whole syndrome, metabolic syndrome, where there is dysregulation primarily due to the fat cells of your glucagon and insulin ratio. And there could be something called glucagon resistance, which is equally important. Suffice to say, life is balance, as Dr. Gerber would tell us, and when the world is out of balance, when your metabolic world is out of balance, it's usually a result of this bad cells. And so, yeah, we don't have the basal metabolic rate, kilocalories per minute per hour. It's going to be influenced by a lot of things, but at the end of the day, it's the cells and it's the metabolism that matter. And so, okay, good questions. Thank you for your participation. Everybody, thanks a lot. This is Dr. Ed Park completing a podcast on diabetes, and I wish you a very happy, healthy holiday season with your loved ones. And mahalo to you, brah. Okay, guys, have a great day. Aloha. Thank you.